Hello everyone. This is Module 3, Chronic GI Disorders. This is the second part of our GI disorders. The first part was acute GI disorders, and now we're going to be talking about our chronic GI disorders. So first is constipation. So the first thing I want to say about constipation is everybody is different. So some people might go to the bathroom multiple times a day. Some people might only go once a week. So the big thing with constipation is you need to know what is normal for that person. So you want to get a bowel history. So when someone comes in and says they're constipated, ask them what is normal for you and ask about a change in their history. So when you're looking at treating constipation, the first thing you want to increase their dietary fiber, make sure they're getting enough exercise, adequate hydration. And then when you move on to medications, there's a lot of different things that you can look at. There's suppositories, there's enemas, laxatives, stool softeners, and now there's prescription medications as well. You want to determine the cause. What's causing this? There's a lot of medications that can cause constipation. Is there anything new or different? Changes in diet, stress, travel. So, what is causing this person's constipation? GERD and peptic ulcer disease. Normally, these people will have epigastric pain. They might feel very full after eating. They might feel full after only eating a small amount. Anorexia. They might have a lot of belching, bloating. You really want to talk about their lifestyle modifications. Make sure that they identify any triggers that they may have. And, they really got to watch out for smoking, caffeine, fatty foods, spicy foods, chocolate, citrus, alcohol, carbonated drinks, garlic, onions, tomato sauce. So, pretty much anything that anybody would want to have. So, it's very unfortunate for them. So, other things, try to sit upright, lose weight, lose clothing, eating small meals, and avoid eating at bedtime. So, peptic ulcer disease. Ulcer in the mucosa, the big thing is you want to avoid perforation. Why? Perforations are bad. So, it means surgery. So, you want to definitely try to avoid that. Treatment for this, PPIs, H2 blockers, and evaluate them for H. pylori. Melena. So, that's black tori stools, likely going to be positive for occult blood, likely from an upper GI bleed. Possibly from peptic ulcer disease. You want to figure out, what is this coming from? Where are they bleeding from? The Great Pretender, if they're taking a lot of Pepto-Bismol, can cause this as well. You always want to investigate the cause if they're having GI bleeding because they could have a cancer, that's going on. So always look into this further. Jaundice, that's yellowing of the skin. Can also be sclera, mucous membranes. A lot of different reasons why they could be jaundice. Could be from decreased uptake, conjunction, or excretion of bilirubin. If somebody comes in and they have painless jaundice, meaning that they're just yellow, but they have no abdominal pain, they really don't have any other symptoms, that is bad news, okay? Bad news. So, they have no other symptoms, they're just yellow. That's almost always bad news. So, you always, always, always want to look into that further. So, dysphagia, so difficulty swallowing, okay, can be with or without pain. Okay, so all of a sudden I'm having a lot of trouble swallowing. So, a lot of different ways you can work this up. Maybe X-ray, like soft tissue of the neck. Maybe it's a barium swallow. Okay, that's kind of you're looking at the function of how they're swallowing. They swallow a whole bunch of stuff. Doesn't taste very good, but they take a whole bunch of x-rays so that they can look and see how they're swallowing. Maybe they need to be referred to GI, get an endoscopy, or maybe they need some other kind of testing. Okay, could be from a structural defect. Okay, maybe they have some kind of an obstruction. Okay, maybe something's stuck in there, maybe something's pushing from the outside in. Okay, maybe they have some kind of a motility disorder, so maybe something's like, not moving the way it should be. Maybe they have a neurological disorder causing this. It could be GERD, could be eosinophilic esophagitis. Maybe it's a thyroid disorder. So, as you can see, there's a lot of different things that can cause dysphagia. So, large differential here. Hepatitis. So, all hepatitis means is essentially inflammation of the liver. So a lot of people think hepatitis and they think, A, B, C, D, E, but also it can be just inflammation of the liver, okay? Could be the virals, which is what everybody thinks of, but also could be from drugs, vascular, or metabolic causes. So, but when you again think of hepatitis, A, B, C, D, E, okay, that's what we always think of. So when you have somebody with hepatitis, it's really about symptomatic relief, preventing transmission if it's a viral hepatitis, and vaccination. We have vaccinations for A and B, so we always want to make sure that people are vaccinated. You always want to refer them to a specialist. Treatments for, there's treatments available for B and C, okay? A is generally a foodborne illness, okay? B and C are going to be more sexually transmitted, IV drug use, stuff like that. D is related to B, okay? So you're not going to have D without having B. E, you're not going to really hear that much about. Hemorrhoids. Those are dilated veins found either externally or internally on the anal mucosa. For those people, increase their fiber, give pain relief, sitz bath. Sometimes they may need a surgical excision. Steroid cream and/or steroid suppository sometimes can also be helpful. Hernias, very, very common. Protrusion of the intestine through the abdominal wall. The severity varies. Some people will live with hernias forever and ever and ever. Okay, they'll be reducible, meaning you can push them back in. Or they'll be incarcerated, meaning that they're twisted and things are not, it's not a good thing right now, okay? Or they could be strangulated, meaning the bowel is dying, okay? And it needs to be taken care of right now, okay? Same thing with incarcerated, it's at risk for dying, so it needs to be taken care of right now. Inguinal 80%, femoral 5%, all others 15%. They're gonna have distension, tenderness, high-pitched or tinkling bowel sounds, decreased gas, they're gonna be in a lot of pain. Okay. If they're incarcerated, strangulated, they either need to be reduced or need surgery immediately. Okay. Otherwise, they may need to be followed up with surgery. You want to discuss complications, straining, smoking cessation, proper lifting techniques, weight reduction with these people. IBS. This is a functional GI disorder. You're going to see it more in women than men. There's the Rome criteria for this. Okay. So make sure you know that. You want to determine the type. Is it constipation based, diarrhea based, or is it a mixed? Okay, so there's different types of IBS. You can treat this with probiotics and prebiotics. You're going to see that a lot. They're generally going to have normal physical exam and diagnostic studies. And the goal of the treatment, improve their quality of life. Okay, and they may need to make some dietary changes, and complementary therapy a lot can help these people a lot. Okay, there's a lot of different treatments for IBS. But again, it's going to be more about the type of IBS that they have. Celiac disease. These people are gluten sensitive. It's an autoimmune disorder and it impacts the epithelium of the small intestine. They maybe have iron deficiency anemia. Diagnosis is based on serological testing, but they must still be on gluten when you do the testing. You can also do it based on biopsies in the upper and lower GI tract from endoscopy, colonoscopy. Again, the testing is going to be better if they are still on gluten. Treatment, strict gluten-free diet. Esophagitis. So I'm going to focus a little bit more on the eosinophilic esophagitis. So that's isolated inflammation, okay, by eosinophils related to food ingestion. These people will have recurrent vomiting, dysphagia, and food impaction. Okay, and so for these people, they need upper endoscopy with biopsy for diagnosis. And they'll need an elimination diet with allergy testing and treatment for these people, PPIs and topical swallowed steroids. Inflammatory bowel disease. This is your Crohn's and your ulcerative colitis. Crohn's, any part of the GI tract, okay? They'll have weight loss, joint pain, abdominal pain, malabsorption, diarrhea, oral ulcers, okay? Goal, control disease, prevent relapses. Usually they are managed with steroids, immune agents, biologics. And ulcerative colitis, it's mostly just the rectum. Okay, their symptoms similar, but they're gonna have weight loss, diarrhea, lower abdominal cramping, bright red blood. They'll also have oral ulcers, and they may have skin lesions. Again, control your disease, prevent relapses. They may be treated with mescaline. I'm gonna say this wrong. I apologize. Mescaline, oral 5-ASAs, or topical steroids. If they have the proctocolectomy, it can be curative. Colorectal cancer, second leading cancer in the United States. Okay, you want to look for, do they have family history, high fat diet, red meat, refined carbs, low plant fiber diet. They're all risk factors. Symptoms might be change in bowel habits, bleeding, bloating, increased gas, distension, weight loss, reduction in the diameter of stool, or no symptoms at all. It's more common in men and increased incidence of age, more common in African Americans. Prevention is the key. And the age for screening went down for the general public with no risk to 45. Okay, so you also want to look if they have a family history, your screening age may be lower. Cirrhosis and liver failure. It's cirrhosis, permanent and irreversible damage to the liver. Could be from chronic alcohol use, viral hepatitis, or non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Always evaluate their liver functions. Could be from a lot of different causes. Treat supportive treatments, alcohol abstinence, dietary supplements, treat their complications, make sure their vaccinations are up to date. Check all your medications because lots of medications go through the liver. And are they eligible for a transplant? Refer them. Gastric cancer. Maybe they feel full, they have a lot of dyspepsia, weight loss. Do they have a palpable abdominal mass? You're going to see this mainly in men, can be in women, but a lot of times in men. Contributing factors, you can see those there. May have a normal physical exam and evaluation, CT scan, labs, and endoscopy. Concern for these people, malnutrition and metastasis. Why? Because you're taking out their stomach, so they're not going to be absorbing as much. Non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. This is becoming a very common thing to see. Fatigue, right upper quadrant pain and fullness, hepatomegaly. It's the most common disease in Western countries. Increased incidence with age, more common in men. Contributing factors, obesity, high uric acid levels, certain medications, and other certain diseases, diabetes. A lot of times, no symptoms. They need to have frequent monitoring for worsening of condition. Risk reduction, decreased alcohol, weight loss, exercise. Cyclic vomiting syndrome. It's recurrent self-limited episodes of vomiting with symptom-free intervals. May be associated with abdominal migraines. Episodes may last hours to days. They don't really know why people have this. You could see this in heavy marijuana users. It's always about the supportive treatment. Complementary therapies could be helpful, lifestyle modifications, and identification of triggers. Abdominal migraines. You're usually going to see this in children. This also has a Rome criteria that is available for them. So you want to use that towards them. Again, they're going to have paroxysmal episodes, meaning they're going to have some episodes where they're good and some episodes where they're not so good. They usually don't have a headache, even though it's called a migraine. They're going to have a history of motion sickness. You want to identify the triggers, and sometimes prophylactic therapy can be helpful. Rectal and intestinal polyps. They could be benign or at risk for cancer. Usually no symptoms, but you can have bright red blood. May have some complaints, diarrhea, constipation, changes to bowel habits. They're going to have a resection of their biopsy, usually along with their colonoscopy. You always want to check when you get your report, do they need earlier or more frequent screening with their colonoscopies? Failure to thrive. This is a lack of weight gain proportional to age, usually from three basic causes: inadequate caloric intake, inadequate caloric absorption, excessive caloric expenditure. If it is an onset between 2 and 4 months of age, it's usually congenital. If the onset is between 4 and 8 months of age, it's usually a feeding problem. History is your most important thing, so you need to take all of these things: prenatal, perinatal, postnatal, developmental, family, and psychosocial, to try to figure out what is going on. And here's your references. I hope this was helpful for everyone.